Okay, good afternoon. Hello. My pleasure to be here on the Jenkins European Conference. In my talk, I will give you an overview about the multi-stage CI system, what we have developed in BMW, but also in my previous roles in Nokia. It will be a little bit different to the other talks in the morning and in the early afternoon. So I'm not going into technical details and plugins and scripts. You will not see code. So I'm more on the workflow. So KK talked a lot just before the break about the new plugin workflow. So I'm more on that level. How to do software development in the embedded environment in bigger projects and how to use then Jenkins in an effective way. So I go through that here. This are the agenda. And please, if you have questions, you can also interrupt me and stop me shortly if something is unclear. I think we have the time for that. So I will say some words about me first, and then I have some questions to you. Don't be afraid, so just a few. Then, what is this development environment in the embedded world? And then, why are we doing a multi-stage CI system? So we heard a lot about pipelines today already, and as said KK, about the workflow, so why we are doing that. And then an overview how we have implemented it, but not in the Jenkins plugins, more on the workflow, how developers and test engineers are working together. Then I have nightly build versus continuous integration. So from my point of view, there is a clear difference. Just a couple of slides about that. And then the challenge what we have in the embedded environment is really this testing in hardware. So I come from Nokia, where we had these mobile phones, the small ones, and now I'm in BMW. We have these big cars. I go a little bit into that, and then just a few recommendations if you are in the same environment. So some words about me. So I'm Robert Martin, 47 years old, and easy to mix first and second name. So just call me Robbie. I have a family, 4 kids. I don't know where to stand. So they keep me as well busy, like my change project in BMW. I have hobbies. In the Alps for hiking, and then once per year I'm organizing an open air in my hometown, just organizing, so I'm not singing. Where do I come from? So I come from South Germany, between Munich and Ulm. There's Ulm, where now also BMW is there, and I live in Langenau, and I had several different jobs in Nokia before I then was asked to lead a big change project, and we developed there 2010-2011 a multi-stage CI system for the S40 platform. So these are not the smartphones, this is more the cheap phones. Then in Ulm, together with other sites, we had then the Linux platform, which was unfortunately stopped by Nokia, and then now I'm really doing the third time this kind of multi-stage CI system with my team to change how software is developed and integrated. So that's about me, and now questions to you. So that I know who is in the audience, that I can also do a little bit interactive thing. So you see the question. So who is a software developer? Please raise your hand. So okay, good, quite a lot. And then test engineers? Okay. Integrators, so getting the stuff from test engineers and developers, good. Also a few there. And then more of these coordination roles, project leader, release manager, a few, good, okay. And then the line manager as well. Okay, good, at least 2 or 3. So next time you should say your bosses, they should also come to here, because they should give you money for hardware, for build systems and so on. So, and then who are CI admins, Jenkins, infra, IT? Okay, so you have a lot of mixed roles, I guess. Okay, good. Development environment for embedded devices. So so just a couple of of my things what I have at home. So landline phone, digital camera, and so many things are embedded all the time with hardware. And it's amazing how much software are in those devices. Nobody really thinks about that. So shortly an overview. So very old phone from us, Nokia. So so these different devices where you have software in which you need to control. Many things are there, flashing, PC connection. So quite complex. And then all the other things, Bluetooth, GPS, and so on. So all of those small chips need to be controlled. So the question is how to make a mobile phone, and this is just an example. You can have also smartphones or digital camera and so on. So as mentioned, I'm more on the workflow. So we have software components, and then you have configurations because you need to deal with different operators or different customers, different regions. So you have compile time and runtime flags, and then for definitely the content. So you want to have ringtones and other things already, and for sure the apps, apps from around the world. This is quite simple, and you can draw it quite fast, but the key is this picture, and don't worry, I don't go into details of the software architecture, but you need to understand that if you want to make products. And very, very important to understand is, we heard a lot this morning as well about Android, app development. So these, all these apps, they are running in the runtime environment of those phones, of iPhone or Android, Samsung S4 or whatever. Depends a little bit on the architecture, but still they are running in a encapsulated environment, and all the other stuff, this was done already by Apple or by Samsung or by Nokia. So, and I'm not talking about those apps, I'm talking about the rest. So this means you need to understand from whom do you get the software parts. And you see the color code, external supplier and internal supplier. So you really need to understand who delivers what. And there are many things are in. And different companies, different culture, different quality assurance. So all these kind of things. And then you are getting perhaps some native stuff inside your company, so perhaps from Berlin, from here, or London, wherever the people are sitting. So now I'm that I bring you through the presentation why multi-stage. I have just an example for today, which is from my point of view, from my experience, quite normal. So let's assume we have 100 software components, C, C++, Java, HTML, whatever you can imagine. It's going to your embedded device. And we have these internal and external suppliers to make this product. And the key question is also very often, so how many developers do you have and how many test engineers? And 3-to-1 here, Microsoft has 1-to-1. Depends usually what I see, perhaps 20 developer and half a test engineer. So this affects definitely your integration chain, your validation chain, if this is not like that or even better. So this I go through with you now in the workflow. So how is this organized so to make this product? And so we have 400 people. And the question is, how do they work together? So how do they share? How do they bring the code together? So every day, test engineers are creating test cases, and then the developers are making their commits to change C files or whatever. So the key question is, I don't say something, perhaps you read. So if you want to deploy just one line of code, one single line of code, a semicolon or I don't know, switch case statement was wrong. So the question is how many people are involved, how many organizations that it's in your product. And very important, so I'm not discussing here how to bring that to production. So imagine we are in Nokia or in in Samsung, yeah. So I'm not talking about when the SOI software is going to production. I'm talking more about the cycle when we develop together this new phone or this new camera. So in the embedded world, we have definitely a challenge. So we have, just as an example, really just the principle. Yeah. So the consumer price for a digital camera, okay, 250 or 500 euros. Yeah. So, but you see now I'm in BMW. So I was happy when Nokia closed Ulm, that BMW opened a site there. So I have now an X5. So it's cost more than 45,000 euros. So, and the question is, how many can we have of them during the development phase for our testing purposes? Yeah. So the key question is, so the prototypes, yeah, when they are not yet on the market, how many of those can we have? Yeah. In Nokia, it was a little bit easier because the hardware cost per prototype was around 400, 500 euros, depending on the mobile phone. Yeah. And if you have 100, okay, it's already money, but now in the car industry, a little bit different, yeah. So this is one challenge what we have in the embedded environment, yeah. short outlook about automotive industry, because I was really not shocked, but surprised and really impressed how complicated this environment is. So in each car there are so-called ECUs, electronic control units, yeah, for all these kind of different things what we have. Yeah. If you drive a more modern car, more and more services are there. Yeah. So, and in this X5, for example, so there are a lot of so-called ECUs, and these are really small embedded devices. Some of them are smaller, some of them are extremely complicated. And then in this X5, more than 20 ECUs are there. So I even don't know exactly the numbers, but it doesn't matter. It's just an example. So, and what is the car doing? Yeah? So why does the cars need so many electronic control units? So these embedded devices. So this blue one is a car, yeah. So and perhaps you know that the car industry wants to go now to autonomous driving. Yeah. So that you can drink a beer or something like that. And then the car is driving without you. Or you are in the car, but you don't need to do something. So this means a lot of stuff there, sensors to get an impression what's going on. Yeah. So where is the pedestrian? Is the guy walking? How fast can I drive? So traffic sign detection, and then the cars. Do they drive? Do they? Yeah. Like this one, it's going back, and so really really amazing what's going on. In such a car. So therefore, short question. So what do you have a feeling? Yeah? So how many, what do you expect? So how many lines of code in a car, in a BMW? Who is for A? Okay, a few people. B? More? Okay, C? Exactly, really, much more than 100 million lines of code, and every day growing and growing, because we put more and more features in, yeah, and this is not BMW specific, yeah? So this is Toyota, General Motors, and all these kind of things. Yeah? So quite a lot of lines of code which can be or can have some small mistakes, yeah? So which then influences the driving. So why multi-stage CI? So I showed you that picture. So really the question is, how are the people working together to get a mobile phone or to get a car or a camera or whatever? So we have 400 people. And now it depends where they are, in which organization they are. So this means really who's delivering what. And then you have these external companies, as mentioned. One is in the US, the other in Romania, the other in in China. So really amazing inhomogeneous system. Typically company structure in organizations, yeah. Okay, you cannot influence external suppliers so much, but internally you can influence, and then you know management, we put these 10 people in London to this box, and they are working with these 50 people in Munich together, and so for sure, we need to group people in a certain way, but then still it's the question, how do they work together to get this software into the system? So, and then very often what I see is that, so this is a software component, one, two, three, four, it's just a label for a software component, and we said one component is changed by four people, yeah, so, and then in Munich there are four teams, and then they group that together, and they integrate it together and release that together to the next level, yeah, so these four components together, so typically, yeah, what I see in that phase, and then if we use that in our example, yeah, so then we have these 25 local delivery hubs around the world. But this is not the end, what management is usually doing. The management is grouping also more of them together, yeah, so, and then, you know, outsourcing in Beijing or in Bangalore, and then they bought a small company in San Diego or whatever, so, and then they group them more together to to have a organizational-based releasing, yeah. So, and then they release everything together, but still only 20 components. And then this means we, in our example today, we have then five global delivery hubs. Be patient, I'm coming very soon to the multi-stage here. So, five global delivery hubs, 400 people, yeah. Still somebody needs to integrate that together. So, in this example in Frankfurt, they put everything together and then make the product release. So the question is, if an organization, if a company is doing that, what are the consequences? So the consequences are that we have a lot of those stages. So how many of the how many stages do you see from a developer until the product? How many? Four, six, five, yes. Five stages, yeah? In that example. I can tell you in the car industry, there are more, much more. Yeah? So, why five? Yeah, we have the developer, so I as a developer do something on a daily basis, independent of my people, independent of the team who is changing the same component. So if I deliver with my three colleagues, then this is the second stage. The third stage is this local integration hub. For sure, it's a very easy global integration hub, and then the product integration hub. Looks all very logic from my point of view, but there are definitely some disadvantages. So first of all, the complexity. Yeah. So let's assume this kind of integration chain. Yeah, and on this software team level, we have four inputs, quite easy, one component. But on the next level, if you are in a local integration hub, if you are an integrator, yeah, and in the second stage here, local integration hub, then you have already 16 people who are doing the work, and then four software components, and then quite easy mathematics, and at the end we have 400 people and 100 software components. This is one view of complexity. The other is now how many commits are coming on each of those stages. So let's assume two commits per workday means 40 in the week. Very simple. At the end of the chain, 4,000. So this is the complexity. Yeah. So and if there are 2% of the commits are wrong, or don't compile, or have static analysis problems, or functional errors, then depending on which state you are, you have problems to integrate and to release it. So the complexity is one, and then this integration hang time is a problem. So how long does it take? I asked in the beginning, so how long does it take, who is involved, and so on, one line of code to the product. Usually, teams are doing two-week sprints. So this means these four people working 2 weeks on their user stories, and then they hand over their code to the local integration hub. Depends on the input quality, how long they need to make this package. So let's assume everybody's of those need as well 1 week. Usually at the end, they need more time, perhaps 2 weeks or 3 weeks, but just as an example. So this means 5 weeks integration hang time of the commit, what I did. If I do a commit today, in my sprint, it takes 5 weeks until it's in the product. So this means it's quite a long way, because if I do a commit here, and let's assume in this local and global, they didn't have problems with my commit, but in the product integration hub, they found out that my commit is not working together with something else. Then they call me, hey, can you provide a fix? And then I need to branch and so on. So this means 2 weeks later, minimum, they call me. So, but I'm in a different sprint. I don't know anymore what I did 2 weeks ago. But it's more as well possible that my commit was done already on Monday. And yeah, I think you got it. So a lot of challenges if you are in a big company doing embedded devices, but it's also the same in web development from my point of view. So these are the problem statements and much more. So what we did in Nokia for which I was also, or in Nokia I was responsible for two multi-stage CI systems, so and then now in BMW, so what we are doing is we are doing a multi-stage CI. So this means we start really on the first stage and provide the developer, together with Gerrit, a very, very fast CI system. And what we are doing there, it starts automatically, okay, not a surprise, very easy with Jenkins. But we focus really on the fast feedback. So put only there things which are really essential, because the developers should not, not getting the feedback after 40 minutes. So, and then the software quality checks, yeah, compiling, unit tests, the others are having static analyzers there. Depends what you want, but focus on the time and on reliability. And now the most problematic thing is coming, so blocking behavior. We have 400 people, yeah, and if there is a, yeah, how to say it, so there need to be a quite high discipline, yeah, so because if a developer is not doing a homework, then he can really influence all the others because his commit is breaking the system. So therefore, we need to block those bad commits. Yeah? So those commits which are not compiling or the unit tests are failing, we need to block. So this is a little bit sometimes hard to get that through these organizations, especially if you have external suppliers or if organizations are far away from your operation. Depends on that. So this is really the first stage to protect the other in your team. Then after this stage is done, we are going automatically after the Gerrit submit. We are going in a so-called team CI, so no manual work there. Then if you have enough hardware, I recommend really to do the already there hardware tests. But as mentioned in the car industry, or if your embedded devices are quite expensive, you will probably not get enough hardware prototypes. Therefore, you need to run that without hardware tests. If hardware tests as well, focus again on the duration. Yeah. So don't do 4 hours testing, because then your chain is slowing down. I will show you later when we are going into in the later stages. And put everything what is possible on that level. Yeah, so whatever you have, put it there and do the blocking behavior. Shortly, an intermediate topic. So very often people are talking about continuous integration, but have in principle a nightly build system. So let's assume this is a working day. So you see the yellow and then the night. So I did a commit, and green means without a problem. And several commits I did, and then in the afternoon I did a mistake, and then I went at home. So nightly validation means I validated it perhaps on my laptop, but not together with the other commits from my team members. The others are working as well. Marcus did also a mistake, and nightly means they are all together. We had two bad commits, so, and I'm coming back in the morning. What do I need to do? We need to debug. Yeah? And debugging is boring, it's not nice, nobody wants to do it, time consuming. So, and if you are really doing change triggered CI, you are really just doing that. So we just take the commits which are going to Git, and then run very fast the CI system. And in this run, yeah, not only compiling, but do everything what is possible, yeah. And then, as KK in principle nicely showed 1 hour ago, we have now this workflow plugin where you can really schedule the different checks either in a sequence or in parallel. But please focus on the fast feedback. Yeah? So, because developer hate to wait for a system. And we in the embedded world, we have another challenge with this hardware. And there are sometimes religion battles. Yeah? So, should I do a system test in the simulation environment before the target or not? So this is up to you. But really focus on this duration. Not having too much time wasted, waiting time. Yeah? So all of that during this stage of this team. So and I'm suffering sometimes in presentations. So what I felt is that when people are talking about build, not perhaps in the Java world, yeah, because if you have Jenkins anyway and everybody is in Jenkins talking about build, then you know exactly, okay, they are also doing static analysis. But in the other world, yeah, in the embedded world, build means I'm compiling and linking, that's it. So therefore, I introduced a CI run as a terminology. So all of those things, what you are doing in this Jenkins job, yeah, it's a CI run, yeah, because in the embedded world, build means compiling and linking. So let's go there. So in this green bubble here, so do whatever is possible, focus on stability and on the duration. And then if you introduce such a system, yeah, it's also an software engineering principle. So when it's red and we are three people working on the same component and Marcus has checked in something, yeah, then it's clear that Timo and Robert are not allowed to commit anymore anything. Yeah? So stop. So clear traffic light in the room or in the emails. So nobody's allowed to check in because we need to get that red run, CI run, immediately green. So it's a development practice. Because if it's red, it cannot go further in the staging, in the multi-stage CI system. So we need to bring it back as soon as possible. And in this example is Marcus went to lunch and then to a meeting. And then Robert and Timo are forced to make the fix. So it's really about discipline as well. So this was this difference between nightly build and change-triggered CI system. So this was stage two. Now stage three, what we have invented, but what we recognize it, that you should not make your CI system concerning organizational wise. No, you should look what do you sell. Yeah? So, and we sell in this example here, it's a mobile phone. We sell, for example, the feature camera, yeah, that I can make pictures. And in the architecture, yeah, so we have either a runtime app or a native app where we have the application, yeah, where you can press the button and so on. But many other components are involved as well in this feature camera. So this means what we have in our multi-stage CI system, a vertical validation on the third stage. So in a mobile phone, yeah, you have camera and you have Bluetooth, wireless LAN, calendar, whatever is needed, yeah, and you have a lot of components which are part in that feature. And we are doing on the third stage such a vertical CI. So this depends how many different features you have, which component is part of which feature. So this is really configuration effort. And then how is this working? So exactly the same like in Team CI, but with more components and then feature based. And it starts automatically. When the Team CI is green, means we can make an automatic merge to another branch in Git, and then this vertical CI is starting. So, and then we validate this camera feature, if this is working. Sorry. So again, focus as well on the duration time that we have a fast staging. So, I recommend until this third stage, run everything in Git. So with handling the branches automatically. But after that, I recommend really not to recompile anymore. So use libraries or RPM packages or whatever technology you have, but definitely with proper dependency management. So we see now stage 4, the so-called system CI, handling now only the libraries. And then we have an integration algorithm which is taking the things from the different vertical CI, is validating those packages, and then doing the steps here. So quite easy to understand. So automatically, again, after the vertical CI was green, yeah. If we have hardware tests, we have 30 minutes, if not 10 minutes. And then again, the same quality checks in like in vertical CI. Sorry, can you repeat?
How do you decide who's to blame if something goes wrong with step?
So the question was, how do we find out who is the guilty or what is the guilty commit, who did it? And thanks for the question, because I jumped a little bit too fast. So we have at the moment an integration algorithm, the most easiest one, one by one. So from vertical CI, these 10 components are coming, and this vertical CI is owned by this team. Yeah. This team is then responsible to find out why the functional test is failing now in the system CI. Yeah? So there are clear test case owners, yeah, test engineers, and they need to find out which commit, or perhaps there are two commits are responsible for the failing test cases on the system CI. This is definitely not easy, so, and therefore also fast feedback. And the key for success is that you don't have 50 commits in this vertical CI, you just have a few of them, 3, 4. And therefore, you need to have a very fast validation, because then the system is going very fast through. But thanks for the question. So on workflow, 4 stages in this example, to have automated the whole chain. Yeah. So a developer is checking in something, then there's software build, unit tests, and then the deployment is happening automatically, yeah? And then like that. So instead of having 5 weeks integration chain, validation chain, interrupts by product delivery hub or local delivery hub, global delivery hub, or whatever. We have a staging system which is automated. And if here's failing something, it's going just to the team back. If it's here failing, it's just going to a bigger team. But still, everybody, all the other people can work because still the product level is working. No check-ins, no commits, which breaks the system. And what we have found out, if you provide the test engineers and these development teams really a fast feedback and an easy way how to bring test cases in, there's a nice principle there, or the people tend to the following. Hey, I can protect my feature when I write a lot of test cases. So test-driven development is then not anymore you need to write your test cases. No, if you have such a system, the team who is responsible for camera, they write a lot of camera acceptance tests because they know that all the things which are going in here are tested with those camera tests. So this means if you focus on your CI system with a fast feedback, reliable feedback, on a testing area, so the development teams together with the test engineers are really doing then test-driven development, which is excellent. So this is this multi-stage CI. Yeah? So principle is, after the commit, nothing else is done manually anymore. Definitely a revolution in many companies, and you need to involve as well human resources, because people who are integrators, people who need to flash the hardware and need to test, they are not needed anymore. Because it's a change to an automatic CI system. So there are only software developers and test engineers at the beginning, and the rest is automated. If you are interested, who is doing that, from my point of view, extremely sophisticated, is Netflix, not in the embedded environment, but they have really this system for their whole video streaming portal already. So if you browse a little bit in the internet, Netflix release process, they have really implemented that to the big scale. In the embedded environment, we have this hardware which needs to be validated. So as I said, I recommend not, or what we found out, it's not worth to have the hardware test in Dev CI. Why? Because of scalability. I don't go into the details. So if we would have the need to have hardware tests in this Dev CI as well, we would need 36 additional prototypes. And if we calculate that, you see at the end, depending on what you are doing, you need quite a lot of money just because of Dev CI. How have we organized the test farms? So what we have per organization, per team, Jenkins masters, which are configured exactly in the same way. Because it's easy. First of all, we heard performance is better, but it's also good in the support model. The other advantage is really that the teams who are in the same organization don't see jobs from other organizations. Therefore, we have per organization, per project, master servers, and then they are connected to a test farm, and they have really stupid workers where we have these prototypes there for running, flashing. Was this a sign that I need to stop? No. So stupid workers just doing the things what is needed, so flashing, running the tests, give feedback and so on. But definitely you should not only focus on this target, so especially if you are limited in prototypes because of different reasons, or management is not giving you the money, this is much more important. So we need to have simulation environment, and yeah. I was happy to hear from CloudBees about this Jenkins Operations Center. So now it's even possible with Jenkins to do such an environment because this simplifies a lot the CI system with these centralized test farms. I come now to the end, so there are a lot of recommendations, but these are just my experiences with my team and from Nokia and from BMW. So what I have learned is integration chain. So management tend to organize the validation, the integration, according to organizational structure, as I showed you. Yeah. So don't do that. Try to convince your management, don't do that. Because we sell products, so we should focus more on camera and Bluetooth and so on, the things what we are selling. Measure how long does it take one commit until your product. Because this is an eye-opener for your management. If you can show it takes 8 weeks until my line of code is there, then what? Because and if you do that automatically, yeah, then you are getting money. You are getting attention. Yeah, so you are getting more build machines. You are getting more test machines. So this is my experience, because management understand the trend curve, you know, and if the hang time is in 8 weeks and it's still going up, yeah, then it's good. Block not working software changes before the product software release. So this is the key. Block. So the key is block the problem at the source. So on the commit stage. If you have enough hardware, then I suggest as well to put the hardware test. But in the embedded environment, it's really hard. Then do it at least in the second or in the third stage, but not the first time in the last stage. That's wrong. Then it's nice. So in one talk in the morning, I heard I'm lazy, so therefore I automate everything. And if you are not lazy, then you are doing something wrong. So very nice statement. Exactly. So after the commit, hey, Jenkins should do the job, and we can write scripts in Groovy and Python or whatever. So do whatever is needed and whatever management wants. Yeah? So and you know, they have a lot of ideas about metrics or reports or whatever. You can shoot them with data. Before product programs are starting in the embedded world, perhaps also in the web area, it's the case, I'm not sure, really request really at the beginning of the milestone when the product is or the program is kicked off in R&D, try to get a lot of prototypes. You need them. External suppliers. In Nokia, we had problems with external suppliers. I'm not saying the names of the companies. So they had 2 weeks release cycle or 4 weeks release cycle. It was really a hard fight to get them on a daily CI system. Yeah. In the automotive industry, it's even more complex. So we are in contact now with more and more companies who provide software and these ECUs, but it's really hard to change. So treat them. So because a developer in company A, outside your organization, is not different than the one sitting to you. Yeah? So they are writing C code. So they need to apply to the same rules, the same principles. Daily commits need to be at the same day validated in your product. And the last one are, these are 10 years old already, but I like still them. If you implement them, you won. And from my point of view, the most important one is everyone commits to the mainline at least once per day. And I have very often discussions, what is the mainline in our organization or in our product? Yeah? So in BMW, it's the car because we sell it. Yeah? So mainline means it's product and not my Git branch, yeah, for my component. This is not the master line or mainline. The mainline is the product. So this means every commit need to be validated in the mainline on the same day. That's the key. Many, many thanks to all the sponsors who made this this event here. Thanks for the invitation and thank you for your attention.